Good morning, everyone. I'm happy to be here. I will do my best trying to make you understand better the geography of the land of the Bible. Nevertheless, I want to tell you that Israel is a sort of, for us Israelis, we don't understand it either. It's like a mathematical problem in which the number of the unknowns is too big to be resolved on all levels, as from the level of the name. You know, I'm coming from Israel, but it is a problematic name for the fact that this tiny piece of land has a whole series of names. When Abraham arrived to the promised land, he was sent actually to the land of Canaan. That's the original name. Then it was called, land of the Jews, or Judea, the United Kingdom of the Israelites. As from the 2nd century AD, it was called Philistia, Palestina, after the name of the Philistines. Up until today, the Palestinians are calling the same piece, the Holy Land, they're calling Palestine, what I call Israel. I'm giving a course in the Palermo University entitled, in Italian, it's Introduzione all'Archeologia Palestinese, Introduction to Palestinian Archaeology. And whenever I have to call my country Palestine, I get a spasm in my tongue. Actually, it might be the way that you are calling this land. That's the key to understand the land. What's the Christian name of Israel? The Holy Land. As simple as that. And the holiness of the land doesn't derive from the land itself, but maybe directly from the sky. It might be a key to understand the name Israel. What's the significance of the name Israel, the literal meaning of Israel? And you know, in the Bible, names has enormous significance. The name of a man, the name of a land, the name of a God has, you know, represent a very important key in order to understand his role, his destiny. What's the meaning of Israel? First of all, the suffix El, you know. I'm not sure. Well, you think that it is God. Generally speaking, in Hebrew, in biblical Hebrew, as from a certain point, El, and we use it up until today in modern Hebrew, El means God in general. What Israel means? Have you got any idea? Israel means fighting with God. Actually, Jacob, if you remember, there's a famous story on the Jabbok River when Jacob struggled, fought the angel of God. He was asking, what's your name? And he didn't want him to say what's mine. He told him, from now on, you should be called Israel because you fought, struggled with God and man, and you prevailed. Guys, I'm coming from a strange country, which name is struggling or fighting with God. And, as from the dawn of history and up until today, there's a lot of fighting there, a lot of God there, up to the point in which I'm ashamed to say that today something like 80% of the Israelis are secular. I'm a secular person trying to educate my children to believe in God, but that's another story, another lecture. According to some, this struggle has a lot to do, struggle with God has a lot to do with the geography of the country. Israel, a tiny piece of land, only 22,000 square kilometers. I think that it is something like 320 times smaller than the United States. You know, we make a lot of noise, but it's really a tiny country. We have from snow in the north on Mount Hermon through tropical climate in the Sea of Galilee. It's water, it's always hot there. Through Mediterranean climate, the area of the Jerusalem and the Samaritan mountains, down to the desert. From the valley of Be'er Sheva south, actually two-thirds of Israel is desert. According to some, the key to understand what's happening in the desert as well as in the cultivated land area is this desert. just to give an idea, in biblical Hebrew, with desert is Tzia. One of the names of Jerusalem, Zion, as you call it, Zion. Zion means desert city. Jerusalem is the only capital city in the world, which is a capital of cultivated land that embraces the desert. The eastern slopes of Mount of Olives and Mount Scopus are touching the desert, which means that, young and restless people, not like you, but like, modern Israelis, whenever they feel stressed, in ancient times, they could always just leave the center of civilization, and after, 1 hour walk, they are in the desert, measuring themselves against the nothingness of the desert. In Greek, for example, desert is eremitas. That's the word. Hermits, which means solitary monks, that used to be originally desert monks, were the monks that used to live in the Judean desert, what they call the desert of Jerusalem. Which means that, and by the way, some of us has, of the modern Israelis has sort of, European look, but we're coming from the desert. If we had the chance to, take a ride on a time machine, coming backwards in time, to something like between the 16th or the 18th century BCE, meeting with Abraham and the patriarchs, you would have classified them as Bedouins, another desert word. In Arabic, Badia is desert, Bedouins, people of the desert. Originally, I belong to a culture that was formed partially in the desert, but this takes us back to the struggle within the land. The most efficient keys to understand the history of Israel, as from biblical times up to now, is the continuous struggle between the desert and the cultivated land, as we call it, the people of the desert and the people of the cultivated land. The story of the ancient Israelites is a story of desert people that managed somehow to conquer what we define as the promised land, which is mostly the cultivated element, the more fertile element in our country. But this struggle was not only a military one, but also and mainly, I would say, a spiritual one, which takes us to this. I was not prepared for this. I'm sorry, I didn't have, I don't have all my, slideshow, but we'll improvise something. Most of the Israelis, we are a nation of 7 million inhabitants. Two-thirds of them are concentrated in the Israeli coastal plain. Probably when you were visiting there, just coming down from the airplane, going to Tel Aviv, you get the feeling of the high density of the coastal plain. When I came here, looking above Arkansas, I saw the Arkansas River and said, wow, how much surface do they have, these people of Arkansas? Israel today, north of the desert, from a constructed area point of view, built area, is the crowdest country in the world. Number two after us is Japan. Number three, Holland. The central part of the coastal plain is called Sharon. Sharon, as you say it. All the Sharons in the world are called after this Sharon, from your Sharon Stone up to our ex-prime minister, what was his name? Ariel Sharon. Sharon or Sharon means, in biblical Hebrew, forest. What takes me to this, we pass from the desert to the cultivated, to the fertile area of the Sharon Valley. You know about the lily of the Sharon, but I'm more interested in the oaks and the pistachio trees, which this forest, this Sharon, consisted of. I need something to write. There is a significance of the language. The Bible is, you know, you have some very good translations. Nevertheless, the issue of the language is very, very important. And here and there, studying Bible, we have to get to the biblical words. Just to give an idea how problematic it is, in Hebrew, you study, this is Bible class, am I right?
Bible class.
We say in Hebrew, Bible, we say the Hebrew word for Bible. What is it? Have you got any idea? I write it down here. This is in Hebrew, Tanakh. That's the word. Tanakh is actually initials of Torah. Torah, you've heard about it. Torah, Nevim, and Ketuvim. And we have, when in Hebrew you say Bible, you mean 24 books. Your Bible comes from Greek, Biblos, the book. Actually, we agree. You know, you consider this book as the book of books. That's why you call it Bible. But your Bible is not our Bible. In our Bible, we have 24 books only. In the complete version of the Greek Orthodox Bible, they speak about 66 books. Now, in the New Testament, 27 books. If you make 66 minus 27, you get 39 books, which means that they have 15 books more. If you compare it with the Hebrew Old Testament, what are these extra books? The apocryphal books, Asmonean, the book of Maccabees, old Hebrew books. For me, it was very strange that through my Christian studies, I came to know about, well, my heritage, you know, the two books of Maccabees and the book of Judith and Tobias, etc. Which means names are sometimes very important. I'm coming back to the Sharon Forest. Two kind of trees that we find up until today in the Sharon Forest, what remained out of it. The oaks and the pistachio trees. In Hebrew, they are being, I don't know if you can see it, Elon and Elah. Elah is pistachio tree. Pistachio tree, and this is the Elon, the Israeli Elon. What's the common denominator between them? You don't have to be an expert botanist in order to see that they have both E and L. They are the trees of El, the same El of Israel that we mentioned before, Carmel, etc. Now I have sort of bad news for us, for me. El originally was not a general name for God. In the Canaanite language, El used to be a private name. It was a private name of the head of the Canaanite pantheon. The one that you see here, this is from Ras Shamra. He was the head of the gods. El, up until today in Hebrew, Eyal means force. His name was the force. Like, what was, like Star Wars or something, if you remember. He had two sons, actually a son and a daughter, the Baal and the Astarte, Ashtoret. Elah is the female form of El, which means goddess, and the tree of goddess, what we call pistachio tree, was a sort of a natural shrine. On its shade, the Canaanites, conducted their cults. When the prophets of Israel were angry against the people of Israel, that they are worshiping upon every hill and under every green tree. You remember? These are the green trees. The green trees are the Sharon. Almost every phrase in the book of Judges, in the book of Kings, begins with, and the children of Israel did the evil in the sight of the Lord, and the wrath of the Lord was kindled against them. Well, you remember it. I remember at my fourth grade, I came to understand that my ancestors always did the evil in the sight of the Lord. And I asked myself and the teacher, why? Why did I do it? I opened in, Judges number 2, right after the death of Joshua. We have a problem, a moral problem. You know, the people of the desert came from the desert. What I'm trying, just try to follow my line of thought. We have, coming back to the idea of Israel, the land of fighting with God, and the Israelites fought also their God, coming from the desert. They were practicing the cult, the rituals dedicated to a God that was accepted, which belief was developed in the desert. His name is Yahweh. Very important. What's the meaning of the name Yahweh? Have you got any idea? That's right. This desert God, abstract God of time, the name Yahweh is a combination of Hoveh, Hayah, and Yihyeh, or in short, Yahweh, or Yahweh. If I have to translate it in English, it's quite difficult, but it's more or less is, was, will, sort of an abstract God of time. Well, these philosophers of the desert, theologists of the desert, when they came from the desert to the cultivated, fertile land, they found here the Canaanites worshipping upon every hill and under every green tree. Well, making good life, I have to tell you. Well, it goes like this. Then the children of Israel did the evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt, and they followed other gods from among the gods of the people who were all around them, and they bowed down to them, and they provoked the Lord to anger. They forsook the Lord and served Baal and the Ashtoret, and the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, so he delivered them in the hands of the plunderers who despoiled them. I apologize for my accent pronunciation, but it makes it more authentic. It's more biblical, isn't it? Now, this is a pistachio tree, Elah tree of the goddess. It's the most widespread, almost the most widespread tree that we have in Israel. What is this goddess? The Astarte, Ashtoret. How you say it in English? Astarte, am I right? Used with the Hebrew pronunciation, or the English one, I think is Astarte. It is mentioned something like, it's more than 200 times this name of goddess is mentioned in the Bible. Have you ever seen the Astarte? I don't know if I can, well, a naked woman here, but, well, what you see here is a statuette that was found in Nahariya, in the northern part of Israel, in Tel Ga'aton. She seemed to be quite anorectic, but I want to tell you. Astarte is goddess of love and fertility in the Canaanite culture. It was considered as a sort of an ideal of beauty. We have some also southern models of her. This is from Tel Lachish, not very far away from Jerusalem. You recognize the clay figurines of the Astarte because she's always holding her breasts. Actually, you know, what I'm trying to show you here is why the Israelites did the evil in the sight of the Lord. They had a good reason to do it, and the reason was this goddess here. I'm teaching comparative mythology. I will say something not very scientific, but this is my feeling, that the ritual life of the Canaanites were actually revealed to the lowest common denominator that I know in all the religions that I studied and met. Their idea was to invite the participants in the cults of the Astarte and to have sexual intercourse with her, to make love with her. Now, for the fact that it's quite hard, it might be hard and even painful to do it with a bronze or, I don't know, clay statue, what was the Canaanite solution? guys. The so-called kdeishot or sacred prostitutes. We spoke about in my presentations. You know, I began with the word kadosh. Kadosh in Hebrew means forbidden. The word for sacred prostitute is kdeisha, which means the forbidden one. It can be forbidden, or for positive reasons, or for negative reasons. These priestesses were forbidden for very negative reasons. We have a description of such a cult in the book of Hosea. I opened in Hosea number 4, and I'll read from verse 10 on. They shall commit harlotry, but not increase, because they have ceased obeying the Lord. Harlotry, wine, and new wine enslave the heart. My people ask counsel from their wooden idols. That's a problem of translation here. In Hebrew, in the original text, is Asherot. Asherah is the mother of, in the Canaanite mythology, is the mother of the Ashtoret. Okay, my people ask counsel from the Asherah, and their staff informs them. For the spirit of harlotry has caused them to stray, and they have played the harlot against their God. They offer sacrifices on the mountaintops and burn incense on the hills under oaks, Elon and Elah and Terebinth, because their shade is good. Therefore, your daughters commit harlotry and your brides commit adultery. I will not punish your daughters when they commit harlotry, nor your brides when they commit adultery, for the men themselves go apart with the harlots of the Astarte. Wow, this is tough. I want to tell you, my wife called me and asked me, how is it in Harding? And I told her, just as I told you, wow, that's the holiest place that I ever visited. And we're living an hour drive from Jerusalem. Unfortunately, in the Holy Land, well, it's all full of politics and struggles, up to the point that, I don't know, we modern Israelis, the option that we have to live religious life of, no, it's not life of faith, religious life, there's a big difference between religion and faith, is, I don't know, to become ultra-Orthodox, something very close to the Pharisees that you remember from the New Testament. That's why Israel today is the most secular country in the world. I tell you how it is connected to our subject. I always think if the modern Israelis today had the chance to have the cult of the Astarte, they wouldn't go every Sabbath to the synagogue. Today it is a sort of, hypothetic problem. For example, speaking about these struggles, when the Israelites, around the 12th century, landed in the Holy Land, in the Promised Land, this cult of Yahweh, God of time, for many of them was too abstract, and they have this very good option, and it was a real problem, not a hypothetical one. And that's why time after time, you know, when they pass from the desert into the fertile areas of the Sharon, for example, preferred the harlotry of the Astarte, up to the point in which this will be, I don't know, the key to understand the scene that you all know that took place on Mount Carmel, another El. You've heard about Mount Carmel. Well, you have your Carmel. The word Carmel is it's a combination of two words, Kerem and El. El is the same god, the Canaanite god. Kerem means vineyard. It's God's vineyard, another fertile, nice place. Probably you remember it. What famous scene took place on Mount Carmel? You remember Elijah the prophet fighting against the prophets of the Baal and Astarte. Well, this prophet, you know, it comes to the point that he takes sort of an axe, and down there on the Kishon River, like a serial killer, just kills 450 prophets of the Baal and the Astarte. And, well, that's an example of what does it mean to struggle with God or against God. According to some of the scholars in the Tel Avivian school, I mentioned them in my presentation, the fact that you use the name, the same Canaanite name, El, as general term, God in Israel, means that, according to them, the first Israelites were actually Canaanites, and we don't have to speak about desert people revolution, but it was a local evolution of Canaanite people. We believe that they are wrong, but that's another story. I just wanted to give you, well, as brief as I could, sort of a general answer how the geography of Israel between the desert and the fertile areas becomes a key to understand the meaning of the name Israel. Any further questions? Go for it. Come on. Make yourself at home.
I think about Abraham and, you know, building an altar under the oak. The more they, you know, they're building altars. You know, so even the worship of Abraham God is clarified by. Is that intentional? I mean, with the oak. And,
well, the sin of Elonei Mamre, it is called Mamre or Mamre. Where Abraham and Sarah met the three angels, were another time under the oak. We have many kinds of oaks that are connected to this or another cult. We have the Elon Bechut, oak of mourning. People used to bury their dead amongst the roots of oaks. Mamre, it's like Moed, it's to prophesy. It's something like oak of the prophet. And actually, as desert people, the first Israelites were, were fascinated by the green big trees of the cultivated land. And it's not that they worship them, but we can see them combined in many important biblical holy scenes. From the oaks of Mamre of Abraham, and the result of this was the birth of Isaac. I hope that you remember it. Through the tamarisk tree that was planted by Abraham as a sign of peace between him and Abimelech, king of Gerar, up to, if you want, I don't know, the cedars of Lebanon that was brought by Hiram, king of Tyre, in order to build the Holy of Holies, the holiest place, at least from a biblical point of view, from a Jewish point of view, in the Holy Land. By the way, what is this place? What's the holiest place for the Jews in the world? Have you got any idea? The heart of the Israeli geography, what is it? You see, wrong. This is what we try to tell to ourselves and to the world, but unfortunately we lie. We lie, yes. I have to admit. I think studying, the Bible, that in a way is, the key to understand the Jewish, the first phases of the Jewish religion. That's a good question. What's the holiest place for the Jews? I want to tell you that when you ask the common Israeli what's the holiest place for Christians, they know all about the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, point of death and resurrection of Jesus. They all know about the Black Stone of Mecca, which is the holiest place for the Muslims. When you ask the common Israeli what's the holiest place for the Jews, they give you the answer that you just gave me, the Wailing Wall. The Wailing Wall was built by King Herod the Great, that is described in the Christian tradition, but mostly in the Jewish tradition, well, hard words, but I will say them. I will tell them because it's all in the Talmud. He's described as a sex maniac, as a distorted man, as a sick man, both mentally, morally, and physically. How come, you know, it just don't fit. How can he be the master builder of the holiest place for the Jews? Well, the holiest place for the Jews, and actually, which is also, I would say, the beating heart of the geography of the Holy Land from a biblical point of view, from an Old Testament point of view. It will take me a minute with your permission. As I told you, I didn't have... What?
Describing Herod.
Yes, okay.
No,
but we have the Jewish tradition is much harder. You know, we are hard people. I'll give you an example, you know, according to you know, in a minute. I would like to find just a minute. Okay, you know what? Let's come back to the presentation of Monday. Okay, here it comes. Well. So, we have it here. Yes, okay. That's the Wailing Wall that you mentioned. It's a very small piece. You know, a wall. What's so holy about this wall, besides the fact that King Herod the Great built it? According to what we tell to ourselves and to the world, is that it's sort of a divine emanation that dwells among the fissures of this wall. And they, I don't know if you remember, they put notes inside. And, well, in direct marketing, it goes directly to the sky, according to their belief. Nevertheless, that's not the holiest place for the Jews. About Herod, the Talmud is writing horrible things. He's from an Edomite origin. He conquered the land in the year 39 BCE by the help of the Roman legions from the Asmoneans. The Asmoneans were a regal house that previously dominated the land. They enjoyed great prestige amongst the Jews, and for King Herod the Great, a good Asmonean was a dead Asmonean. The problem was that his beloved wife, Miriam, was an Asmonean. Asmonean blood ran in her veins, and therefore, according to the Talmud, he killed her, he strangled her, preserved her corpse with honey. And let me stop here, with your permission. Anyway, the worst was yet to come. His sons that were born to him from Mary the Asmoneans were also, according to him, Asmoneans. So therefore, he killed also them. Augustus Caesar coined the famous phrase back then, claiming that it's better to be King Herod's pig than his own son, if you remember it. So, well, it can't, you know, we cannot accept theologically that this distorted man was chosen by God to build the holiest place for the Jews. Well, the holiest place is the Holy of Holies, and the Holy of Holies lies here. We're coming back to the idea. That's the rock of the Dome of the Rock. I don't know if you had the chance to visit the place. Now, because of the last circle of violence, probably for another 10 years it will be closed. We're coming back to Israel, a land of struggling with God. The Muslims, by the way, that are worshiping, you know what? According to the ultra-Orthodox Jews, the same God, are holding this place. An ultra-Orthodox Jew will never get inside the church. For him, it's sort of an abomination. Nevertheless, it's very strange. If they come to a city in which they don't have synagogues, they are obliged to enter a mosque and to pray there. By the way, they will be kicked out because the Muslims don't want them there. But just to give an idea how complex the situation is, anyway, this Golden Dome, one of the commercial symbols of Jerusalem, every time in the CNN, whenever they talk about Jerusalem, This is more or less the slide that they put. Well, these Muslims that you see over here praying towards Mecca, by the way, are holding the holiest point in the geography of the Holy Land, which is also, it came to be also the symbol of the struggle that we have with the various, I don't know, versions of God. And this is it. That's the rock of the Dome of the Rock. And it is holy for three reasons. First, it is called the Rock of Foundation. This is not in the Bible, but in the Talmud, the Jews believe that this was the first thing that was created 5,771 years ago. We have a different, the religious, the Ultra-Orthodox, they have a different count of years. And for this reason, and we're coming back to the Bible, Abraham was told by God to take his own, his single beloved son, Isaac, and to take him on the top of a mountain that I will show thee. And what you see here is actually this top of mountain. Temple Mount is actually Mount Moriah. It is covered by this artificial square that was built by King Herod the Great. But it is used to be a natural hill on which top, according, I believe also, you know, it did take place 4,000 years ago, right here in this place. You know, Isaac begins his life under the oak of Aloné Mamré that was mentioned here. But one of the most famous scenes that are the most climax of his life is the famous binding of Isaac for sacrifice. That is very important also from a Christian point of view. And it took place right here. I want to tell you that also for you, Temple Mount, from a Christian evangelical point of view, Temple Mount is important. If you remember the Holy Week, from Sunday to Sunday, inside Jerusalem, not speaking about Mount of Olives, there's no other place within the Old City where Jesus spent more time than Temple Mount. Stories of the widow's mite and the overthrowing of the tables of the money changers. You remember these stories. That's why we're not allowed, Jews as well as Christians, to visit Temple Mount. That's a regulation of the last year. We're not allowed to climb the mountain with our Bibles. They confiscated, that's a new Bible that I got from somewhere, they confiscated my Bible because Israeli policemen, because, well, the tension is so high lately. So we mentioned two reasons for the holiness of this place. Rock of Foundation, one. Second, the binding of Isaac for sacrifice around, I don't know, maybe 4,000 years ago, maybe a little less. And for these two first reasons, there's reason number three. Around 950 BCE, King Solomon is building right here, according to what God told him. He's building the house of God, the Holy of Holies. This was the end of my presentation. I told them that, you know, the wet dream in life of every Israeli archaeologist is to have the chance to excavate around here and to find, the remains of the Temple of Solomon, which is much more important and significant than the Herodian one. Otherwise, what we have is the Wailing Wall. Actually, the Wailing Wall came, you know, we market it as the holiest place for the Jews because it's the nearest accessible point that the ultra-Orthodox, you know, can get to what you see here. Okay. Temple Mount is, you know, I began with the meaning of the name Israel and would like to conclude the story with it, just to close the circle. Temple Mount is not a temple, it's not a mountain. It's a barrel of gunpowder. We have, I don't know, oxygen, burning material, temperature. The only missing thing is the spark that will ignite it, that will make it all explode. And I'll tell you why. Because today, that's the first time in 4,000 years history of the Holy City in which the rulers of the city, they don't rule the holiest point in the city. Who are the rulers of Jerusalem? More or less us, Israelis. Who rules Temple Mount? It's not that clear. Officially, it is King Abdullah II, King of Jordania. Nevertheless, the local people of the Waqf there, they are inspired by the Palestinian Authority. By the way, I have to tell you something. In 1969, 2 years after the Six-Day War, when we came in power there, a nice Christian guy by the name of Michael Ron, he came from Australia, he said that for the fact that, you know, that we must rebuild the temple in order to try to understand how Jerusalem was in Jesus' time. So therefore, he entered this chapel that you see, this dome that you see here with, I don't know, two small tanks containing kerosene or something. Not explosive. I think it was kerosene or something like this, gasoline. He just put it on the rugs, set fire. Nothing happened. And actually, after they managed to take off the fire, because of the heat, the stucco from above of some parts fell down, and some ancient Kufic writing were exposed. And up until today, we're working on its deciphering, which means for this bad thing, it came out a good thing, but I don't know. If you, sir, will try the same trick now, you know, who knows what will happen. As I told you, it's a barrel of gunpowder, and I don't know to what God we have to pray that things will get better. Blessed will be the peacemakers. I do believe that the only one that they have the power to impose solution in the Holy Land because of all these struggles of with God or without God are the Christians. I mean a combination of, I don't know, of the European and American forces, even though you're a little bit tired of what happened to you in Iraq. What do I tell you? With God's help. Any further questions? Yes.
We've got about 2 or 3 minutes. Do anybody have any questions? The last chance to
come on
archaeologists.
No, not okay, I will. So I will impose myself on them. You're not asking, so I'll ask myself questions and I will answer. No. You know what I will ask you? I see, well, the McIntyre building is, you know, center of world missions, am I right? And Bible. You're sending missionaries all over the world, from Kenya to Tanzania to I don't know where, New Zealand even. What about us? Why are you neglecting us? In Romans 10, 9, 10, and 11, they speak about, my heart is with my brethren, the Israelites. You have very good excuses that it's against the law here, against the law there. But we need, I want to tell you, biblical Judaism, and you see it, you know it very, very well when you read the Bible, like the Quran, are very belligerent texts. We blame generally the Muslims for their idea of jihad, but the first time that we find the idea of jihad is amongst, you know, in the Old Testament, against Midianites, Amalekites, the Canaanites. We don't have this clear message of peace that we find in the New Testament. I do believe that the New Testament might be the real give the right perspective for the Old Testament. I know that you have some very good excuses. Nevertheless, we really miss such teaching. And I want to tell you, whether you like it or not, the Holy Land is your homeland. You think from a religious point of view that it is, I don't know, Israelis against Palestinians, Jews against Muslims. In the last 2,000 years, those that struggled on the whole wrath of the Holy Land were Muslims, 1.2 billion people, which is the number of Muslims, against 2 billion people, and that's the number of Christians. We have the Byzantine times, the times of the Crusaders, the British were there. I do believe that the only solution in the end, let's leave religion on a political level, will be Christian presence in our international presence in an internationalized Jerusalem. As I told you, whether you like it or not, yeah, well, you will be there. Exactly 10,004 years ago, at the year at year 10,004, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre was burnt and shattered and smashed to pieces by Bi'amar Allah al-Hakim, the sixth Fatimid Sultan. Can I just conclude the phrase? The reaction of the Christian world, what was it? 1099, the Crusades came, two generations after. Some of my, you know, when I work with many Catholic friends there, priests and stuff, and I was kidding at them, said, the year 2000 passed, the millennium, nothing happened. They were very angry at me, and Padre Policarpo, which is a friend of mine, already speaks in, like an Israeli, in a very non-politically correct manner, he told me, horrible people like you, you know, said the same in the year, in the first millennium, and then came the year 1099. Let's wait to 2099, and let's see who will be ruling there. I tend to believe that whether I like it or not, he's right. I thank you very much. Thank you very much.